I've talked a lot about Hollow Knight, but what about Silksong? After all, we have enough information to get an idea of the direction the second opus of the franchise will take, both in terms of art and gameplay. In 3 years already, we've had 2 trailers, 20 minutes of gameplay featuring 2 areas, a long article in the February 21 issue of Edge last year, some NPCs and some very nice musical themes, so some elements are taking shape quite precisely. I tried as much as possible not to limit myself to what is known, which has undoubtedly already been the subject of many videos, but to analyze it a little more, especially in the last part of this video. So, what does Silksong have in store for us? Hornet is a character very different from the Little Knight. Taller than the Little Hero from the first game, she also looks older. As she's not made of void, she's, a priori, not sensitive to soul either. She's the daughter of the Pale King, but her mother, Hera, Queen of the Spider Tribe, is not of noble lineage, contrary to her former companion. So we know that her combat gameplay will be in addition to her sharp needle based on tools. Thus, magic seems rather put aside for her, which is to be nuanced, however, because the silk she uses with her needle seems unusual and is associated with a new, rich imagery. She's a rather down-to-earth character, a virtuoso fighter, but most of all she's determined, and will seemingly do anything. During her first fight in Hollow Knight, she threatens us as she's waiting in front of another dead vessel. She's standing there on the ground. This is an image that one may find quite violent, actually. Having a large circular attack, this can lead to more intense fights with more enemies. She can easily take down several mobs simultaneously. It will surely require more enemies for the game to be balanced. You play as a talent and Huntress, after all. As far as her movements are concerned, they will be more dynamic than those of the Little Knight. We could see that she will have a ledge grab, she interacts with the environment, she is fully aware of it, there will be air currents that she can take advantage of, and one or several escapes. She can sprint, she has more acrobatic jumps, she has a tucked somersault, a twist, she feels the ground more, she needs an impulse to jump, and if she's running, when she changes direction, she slides a bit. This aspect of physics is quite realistic. The platforming physics will be different too. Combining the weight of her needle with the speed of her silk thread, her weapon can act as a grappling hook that is not organic like Ori's, but whose physics is more nervous-aggressive. The sound design will also be rawer, probably less dreamlike, more aggressive, maybe even more rhythmic. It has been well highlighted in the trailers where it responds to the rhythm of the string instruments. It seems likely that there's been or will be a training for her. Why the vessels seem to have magically appeared, and we didn't even know where their weapon came from. It will be interesting to see how the improvements, the new abilities will be integrated, certainly in a less poetic way than for Hollow Knight. Hornet is more earthly. However, her heritage will be important. We know that she will be able to move like a spider, unless it's been removed. She probably couldn't learn this from her mother, whom she didn't get to know, or for very little time. But is that something you learn, actually? Could I learn this myself? Anyway, it's safe to assume that many other things about her lineage, whether from her father or her mother, will be mentioned or even clarified. As Hornet is more aware of herself and her surroundings, she interacts more precisely with her equipment, and several mechanics may appear or be refined compared to the previous game, which is all the more interesting as it may synergize, it's discreet but it's there, with the way the Farloom universe is developing. Combined with silk and industry, trade can be an integral part of the diegesis. Merchants may be more numerous and less based on random encounters. I don't doubt that there will still be some, though. And the currency mechanics will be interesting, since there will be a choice to make. Keep your bids as they are, or have them put on a string. This is certainly discreet, but it is also a way to show the heroine's awareness. It has been shown that her health masks could be changed. The more recent trailer showed that the ornament of her HP bar could change to even taking the shape of a harp. I guess it's related to her tools, as Hornet will be able to switch between several gears, one for farming, one for fighting, and so on. You can add mechanics that are practical, and you can also have mechanics that are practical and justified by the personality and the level of awareness of your playable character. Do you need a flutist, Team Cherry? I don't see why, but just in case, I'm there. Last thing, in the Nintendo Treehouse gameplay, there was a kind of riddle. Puzzles would not be surprising. Farloom is a world bigger than Hollow Nest, with more varied locations, more inhabited too. Its dimensions are even larger than Hollow Nest, the gate in the opening cutscene is huge, and many of the enemies in the game are servants of the Citadel. We know that monsters will also be more numerous, bigger, and of course there will be a lot of friendly NPCs. Having a lot of NPCs for a silent hero wouldn't have made much sense, so it was very balanced in Hollow Knight. Hornet being older and having a mind, a voice, she will be able to respond, interactions will be two-way and there might be less implicit. There may also be an even deeper work on emotions and most of all the humor, even the unexpected. In the previous video I talked rather briefly about humor in Hollow Knight, how the animation, among other things, gave a very humorous aspect to some movements thanks to the management of time and keyframes. I didn't go in depth voluntarily because I think that Silksong will allow us to be even more aware of the importance, the richness of the humor of the different types of comedy in this franchise. It may be a detail, but Hornet's size already allows for some comedy. As she is tall, some NPCs are about as tall as her, others are not. When she talks to Forge's daughter, she tilts her head completely horizontally. This couldn't be emphasized in Hollow Knight since the Little Knight was very little, so they always had their eyes slightly looking up. There is little doubt that Silksong will allow for more interactions, more in-depth dialogues certainly, but perhaps also more cutscenes, or at least real scenes. The interactions in Hollow Knight were certainly varied in the quantity, importance and emotions associated with each NPC, but they were relatively similar in how they were shown. The Little Knight was listening to the NPC. Silksong also promises a kind of theatricality, a more refined way of staging the interactions, if only by the presence of several NPCs at the same time. I'm thinking in particular of this short scene in the first trailer, where Hornet is surrounded by three insects, one static, a merchant it would seem, and two others moving, one flying the zipline, like another one in the background, the other singing and doing a pirouette, while Hornet is waiting on her bench as impassive as the Little Knight. It's the deadpan family. What are the heroine's interactions with these NPCs? I wanna know. Now. The staging can also be done by other details. We can already see that a fight seems to be set in a specific place that's against the light. That's nice. Already we can see that these are more extroverted characters. There was no real physical comedy in Hollow Knight. Silksong seems to be quite rich in it. The characters sing, dance, cook with more or less violence. This extroversion may suggest that the world we will explore is not as asleep as Hollow Nest and its stasis due to the infection. The reasons why enemies will attack us may also be more varied. It seems that there would still be a sort of spell for these little bugs, but probably of a different nature than the one that chained the minds of the inhabitants of Hollow Nest. Moreover, the beings that lead us to get to the top of the Citadel may be more numerous. Another thing I'm looking forward to, in my case, is the greater versatility of NPCs in their relationship with Hornet. If I already mentioned in my first video on Hollow Knight the organic and yet sometimes surprising character of the NPC's behavior, a friend who becomes a partner in combat, boss who suddenly confides in us, Silksong should logically explore this aspect a bit more. Again, thanks to Hornet having a voice, feelings, and apparently a destiny, in a world that seems far more awake than Hallownest realm, it has already been made clear that NPC's relationships with Hornet may well be more uncertain than in Hollow Knight, especially those associated with core mechanics such as mapping and fast travel. If both Hornet and the NPCs have a more specific purpose than their equivalents in Hollow Knight, their relationships may well prove more changeable. Finally, here we have a heroine with a story that has certainly not been revealed that much, but perhaps less mysterious than that of the Little Knight, who sadly took with them all the answers about their true nature. The questions about Hornet are multiple because they are related to her past, her childhood, her potential training, and her present, her being captured. It is a plethora of emotions that opens to us for this new opus. For all that, we know a lonely Hornet as much as the Little Knight. The latter's loneliness, however, was all the more peculiar as it was linked to a birth that was at first mysterious, then tragic as we got to understand the origin of the vessels. For Hornet, it is a loneliness in which we can perhaps project ourselves more easily, more human loneliness, although in my case I find it very easy to identify with the little hero of the first game. In the case of the heroine, this loneliness coupled with her emotions could perhaps lead to moments of introspection. Although the music we've listened to for now puts the emphasis on action, being much more dynamic than Hollow Knight, with in particular more detailed work on rhythm, there is also the music of Bon Bottom, highlighting the violin, probably the instrument associated with Hornet, it was the case in Hollow Knight. But that doesn't mean this piece in particular will be associated with Hornet's introspection, it just sounds extremely melancholic. Another sad lore for this place, I suppose. Concerning the music, in the first game, Hornet used the royal theme in a personal way, of course, and especially in its own key, A minor. But we haven't heard the royal theme for now. It is the Dies Irae that seems to be one of the new themes of the franchise. This is not insignificant, because it's a religious theme, it's a Gregorian chant, certainly very much used in all music styles, but given the large presence of religious undertones in the franchise, I am eager to see how much it will be used, whether or not it will be Hornet's theme, I don't think so, or a more general theme, I suppose it's more like this. The main leitmotif of Hollow Knight was, to me, already more than just a theme associated with a character, since it was associated with a function, that of the vessels, thus with a set of characters, just as the second main theme was associated with royalty, and could be found even in the White Defender's theme, for example. We have already heard the Dies Irae several times, in the menu loop, the introductory cutscene, the music of the first trailer, and at the end of the demo before encountering the NPC that causes Hornet to faint, Churchkeeper. It can be noted that it is treated, for now, in two different ways. A classic version, where the theme is taken as is. And another one, less direct, in the menu loop. Here the theme is modified, it is transposed to the upper third without changing the key, which gives it a more suspended character. Thank you. We can hear that this loop is much softer than the one in the first game. The dominant, the E, takes a larger place, and the clarity of the harp succeeds to the depth, to the obscurity even of the viola. Precisely, concerning the instrumentation, Hornet had the violin as an instrument. The royalty was represented by the harp and the oboe. For the moment, the strings dominate in the extracts that we could hear, as well as the harp, which we find in the imagery of the game. I will detail that a little further. The woodwinds are discreet for the moment. They have an important place in the first zone, however, more grotto, more natural, less ordered than the citadel. We could also hear the music of the forge close to infrasounds. Okay, maybe frequencies not that low. I'm always a bit hyperbolic. Christopher Larkin has great mastery in different musical styles, even though the Hollow Knight franchise uses mostly the orchestra with a touch of metal for Grimm. I hope Mr. Composer will be able to use his sound knowledge in an even richer way. We already know that the score will be rhythmically richer, with already the use of a 5-4 time signature inlays sometimes, wonderfully translating the vivacity of a fight in which the two fighters interrupt each other in turn as the musical theme is interrupted when a new bar begins. I mentioned a moment ago that Hornet had its own key, A minor, which was one of the few pieces from Hollow Knight in this key, the whole score generally focusing on C minor and E minor, and D minor for the radiance. This great coherence in the harmonic framework was very appropriate for this subterranean and sleeping infected realm, with a vanished past, fragile present, and very uncertain, even unimaginable future. A world that is more alive, more versatile, can call for more harmonic versatility. In comparison, the score of Ori by Gareth Cocker is extremely rich and fluid in its harmonic evolutions. The keys are easily connected and illustrate the hyperbolic character of Nibel and Nywen and the very cinematic aspect of the games of this franchise. I always say Ori is hyperbolic. I do apologize. Falun may not have this flexibility, however, we can imagine something more open in the music. For now, this key, A minor, Hornet's key, is present in the menu loop and in the second trailer. We also found again the dominant keys from the first opus, C minor and E minor, but it will be very interesting for music lovers to see if the harmonic framework remains rather closed or opens to other keys, and especially if it gets to be more organic. Where the music in Hollow Knight had multiple purposes, sometimes descriptive, but mostly driven by a need for narration in a world almost reduced to silence, it seems that in this new game it is an element of the story itself of Silksong. As in the first game, the first seconds connect us to the story, thanks to a few lines from a poem. After Mornemon the teacher, it is time for a conductor, Romino. The little characters who escort the cage where Hornet is locked up all have a bell on which the camera lingers very quickly, underlined by the sound design even more musical than in Hollow Knight, especially in the forge. The bells on the benches obviously make sounds.
Shaky. For him. I love the little sounds all throughout the game.
Hornet is able to play music with her needle. Quite honestly, I feel more like she's making a threatening gesture and getting ready to get the NPC in front of her, but it would appear she is serenading. To the point where it would be a gameplay element. This is not surprising, music is a prominent element of Silksong's imagery. Indeed, if we can assume that music will be part of the story of the work, this is because it's very present in the graphics and imagery of the game. There are the bells, of course, we have seen them a lot from the beginning in the tunnels that Hornet crosses on Bugback, in the cities she discovers, the characters also seem to be musicians. It's more light than rooms filled with bug corpses. Some enemies have bells on their heads or use cymbals to attack. One of the sets, the one where we see Queen Carmelita, is strongly inspired by the balconies of an opera house. It's like the Colosseum of Fools, but with small alcoves typical of theaters, essentially operas. Trobbio also seems to be associated with a kind of show. Well, a Team Cherry-style show. Even Lace seems to have a conductor's gesture before her first fight against Hornet in the docks. We are bathed in musical imagery, all the more so when coupled with another, the Weavers, one of the tribes from the first opus. Indeed, the symbolism of the taut thread, like the string of an instrument, is omnipresent. Real threads, or structures with straight and parallel lines, like threads. Sometimes we don't even know anymore. There's a lovely mix between the loom and the harp, as if sometimes the loom was a giant harp on which we could play. The harp is very present in the orchestration of the franchise. I'll never get a fancy flute solo. I'll have to accept that. The two elements still mix in Farloom's written language. Pins blend with musical notes. Where Hello Nest was an engineering realm, Farloom seems to be more about industry. We've only seen the docks, the forge, and those pipes on Hornet's Edge magazine cover artwork, which we see in the second fight with Lace, but there will also be the weavers, obviously, and these mysterious white flowers. This importance, the weight of industry, has an impact on the color palettes, which use more metallic hues, bronze or copper in particular, rather than stone. Once again, it's a world that has been built, where civilization has taken a large place. If there are indeed leaves in the foundry, they are drawn in a dark, warm green, as if the vegetation was almost burned by the heat of the place. That is not good for greenery, I suppose. The omnipresence of metal is, of course, audible, thanks to the sound design. Many enemies are sort of faceless, their heads are hidden under a bell or a helmet. This can be heard, the voices are modified. Yet the whole world remains often quite dark and enclosed, with even skeletal elements planned for Hollow Knight but put aside during the game's development phase. Nevertheless, Silksong seems to be a rather warm game, at least in parts, where Hollow Knight was cold, made of stones, leaves and crystal. The mine, where the little infected bugs were still working, was hollow, shiny but cold, hard and brittle, although there was this suggested musicality with the guitar harmonics in the soundtrack. And one didn't really know what was done with all that crystal. In Silksong, it seems different. The characters from the Citadel, the ones who surely kidnapped Hornet, are still alive. Does their work still have a purpose? Would this world take some distance with the stasis of Hollow Nest? Hornet is still very often shown in a hot environment, mostly the docks in the promotional art of the game. However, we know that some areas will be more vibrant with corals, and especially the first area, Moss Grotto, quite different from Greenpath or the Queen's Gardens by its almost exclusive use of a very vibrant green without shades, where the green areas of Hollow Knight had a nice counterpoint with the purple and metal. Hollow Nest is a blind and blinded world. There are few real connections between the characters, nor do the workers communicate. Occasionally there is a glimpse of light, as with Shio and his new friend and former nailsmith, but it is admittedly rather discreet. Sometimes characters just go, leaving behind this city, this kingdom, which can't give them what they want. Cloth and Britta may leave Dotmouth and Hollow Nest, depending on how we follow their storyline. It's a world in the image of the infection. It's different in Farloom. There is communication, like with the quest boards. Moreover, the means of transportation are for some used, like the zip lines we saw in the first trailer. The architecture of Hollow Nest is often based on two things, Hollow Nest Seal and the eggs. The eggs represent birth and are also a reminder of rebirth, of the king's metamorphosis from worm to radiant bug, but they may also be a part of the pre-Hollow Nest imagery when the void was opposed to the radiance. The Hollow Nest seal symbolizes the king's power, his near omnipresence. There is a third element in the imagery, not in the kingdom's original imagery, but in the game's imagery, an element that has been added. Corpses. They are everywhere. Three aspects are thus shown, birth, rebirth by the eggs and the Hollow Nest seal, and death. The cycle is complete. The omnipresence of bodies give the impression of a finite world whose rebirth is very uncertain, despite the gentle but timid hope the hero can slowly instill. Farloom's imagery, in addition to the music and the weavers I previously mentioned, shows something connected but a bit different, some kind of spines. Would these still be bodies or something more related to a sort of anchoring or even evolution? Or just the idea of an ancient world, fossilized, as in Hollow Nest? We'll see. Hornet is mostly known as the protector of the kingdom, the Huntress, though often too in a short scene near the body of her mother Hera. She is a violent protector. She kills the other vessels, at least one, and she's about to do the same with us. How does she consider them? As a threat? As an enemy? Does she grant them humanity? Does this supposed ease of attacking them, she often insists that she's not afraid to use her needle, again betray the fact that the vessels are reduced to a mere function? Little is known about Hornet, too, beyond the fact that she's a princess, huntress, and protector. So what is her true character? Has she lived? Quite simply, who is she? Can she even know it, she who has not really lived anything? One thing is certain, Hornet can be the embodiment of choice. Indeed, she has mechanics that let her decide, as we've seen before. They also translate the player's choice, a more assertive choice in a franchise they are now familiar with, but that undoubtedly still has many surprises in store. In Hollow Knight, the knight doesn't make choices among NPCs. Nothing shows them being closer to any one of them. But they do have a choice to make, since there are several endings. However, they aren't given any key to choose this path. They have to guess. Everything is implicit. It's a world of secrets where things are kept silent, forgotten even. I had mentioned in my video on the lore this ambivalence between all the elements associated with memory and the oblivion in which many things or characters have fallen. There is not even a riddle to make us guess the path to take. It is almost luck. Would the little knight be a symbol of this luck? The same luck that allowed them to escape the abyss and leave Hollow Nest before returning there. Also, Hornet has a defense, one that is intrinsic to a range of possible actions. She can indeed parry. The little knight could eventually protect themselves, but it was thanks to charms they were still fragile. Healing isn't even an issue for Hornet, as it's instant and can be performed mid-air. She can't really be shown as a fragile character. She is very skilled. Well, we've never seen her looking fragile, rather. Or when she was, something allowed her to be freed. The knight had, consciously or not, always sacrificed themselves. But if Hornet is aware, she is also aware of danger. She had cautiously entered the Temple of the Black Egg at the last moment, and her potential sacrifice as a new dreamer was only due to the choice of the little knight, a choice that probably turned out to be non-canon, but still. Thus, Hollow Nest imagery, the cycle, life and death, is like the world itself and like the vessel, born and sacrificed, born and dead. But the exploration gameplay in Hollow Knight, the way we find things, by sheer luck sometimes, is also like the world. It's a silent gameplay which doesn't say things, in a world where many things, many people have been abandoned and forgotten. It's also silent, like the little knight. Finally, the gameplay of the vessel themselves is like their sacrifice, defenseless. At the beginning, the little knight was free in Dirtmouth Heights. They then faced imprisonment and sacrifice. Hornet, on the contrary, starts with imprisonment. So maybe the world of Farloom will also be like Hornet, a world that defends itself in an active way, not a blind defense due to the infection, a world that chooses, a world with its secrets, but less silence thanks to a heroine who also speaks and can therefore make the world speak in another way, a world that discovers itself as well as the princess who will perhaps also transcend this function, the same way the Hollow Knight wanted to transcend their own condition, but will be able to actually live a richer adventure. Hollow Nest made most of the characters smaller. It was locked and locked them up. Perhaps Farloom will be set free, or it will set them free.